Nemo Radio is on the air.
A, B, C. A, always, B, B, C, closing. Always be closing. Always be closing.
Shirley, you can't be serious.
I am serious. And don't call me Shirley.
Put that coffee down.
Coffee's for closers only.
Come after me! I'm a man! I'm 40!
Hey, it's John Nemo. Welcome back to another episode of Nemo Radio. So excited to share this insight with you today. It's so fascinating to me because I literally saw it in action last night with a group of 7th, 8th, and 9th grade boys. So let me explain the story behind this. What happened was I was running basketball practice for one of my sons, Alex, for his team. And there's a player on the team, let's just call him Tommy. Like, not his real name. But when no one's looking, he, you know, and when kind of the spotlight is off of him, and when I watch him just kind of on his own, he's a good player. Like, he can make a bunch of shots. He's good at handling the ball. He makes good decisions. But whenever the spotlight comes to him, and whenever, people are watching him, he shrinks back. He's very timid. He just kind of shrugs his shoulders, acts like he doesn't know what's going on. And what was so fascinating last night was, as a coach especially, you're always trying to figure out, how do I, you know, push a person's buttons? How do I get the best out of a player, even in, you know, 7th, 8th, and 9th grade rec basketball? And so I'm trying to figure out how to kind of unlock Tommy. And what was interesting was I put him in a position where he was forced to be in the spotlight. Like, he couldn't shrink back. He couldn't hide. And I also put our best player to defend him. And I put the ball in Tommy's hands, and I wanted to see what would happen. And what was interesting was our best player went right at him and kind of was like, I know this guy's tentative and he's passive, and stole the ball from him a few times. And you could see Tommy kind of, you know, getting a little bit humiliated, kind of got, you know, like he was too tentative and I got the ball stolen. And I, you know, tried to encourage him and positive reinforcement and everything like that. What was really interesting was, so we ran the plays, whatever. And Tommy didn't fully come alive, but when I flipped and then our best player started the play with the ball in his hands and I had Tommy defending him, Tommy was like an animal unleashed, like raced up, tried to defend the guy, really tough. And then later in practice, again, I saw Tommy kind of come alive in a different drill and really start taking over and making shots. And then in the final game, the final drill that we did, it was Tommy versus our best player again, and Tommy beat him. He made like 8 out of 10 three-pointers. And so I pulled Tommy in front of the whole team. And I don't know if it'll be interesting to see how this plays out, but I pulled him in front of the whole team and I said, Tommy. And he's like, huh? Looking around, like you could tell he did not want the spotlight on him. And the whole team's watching, you know, team meeting. And I say, shoot the dang ball. I didn't say dang. I actually said a stronger D word. But I said, shoot the ball. And I said to our team, is Tommy a great shooter? And everyone on the team was like, yeah, right? And so that his peers are giving him the feedback. And then I said, if we want to win more games, what does Tommy need to do? And the whole team's like, shoot the ball. So what's going to be interesting is we have a game Saturday. So I'm gonna keep trying to get Tommy to come out of his shell and shoot the ball. And the reason I'm starting with this story is it is a story I'm very, very familiar with, and maybe you are too, but holding yourself back, kind of inhibition. And for most of my life, people always don't believe this when they meet me, or maybe you don't believe this listening to me. I held myself back. I was a huge kind of introvert type person as far as behavior. I never let my real personality out. I always held back all through grade school and junior high, even up until almost halfway through my senior year of high school. And that's when I finally was able to let my real self out, which is crazy, gregarious, life of the party, tons of, you know, jokes, all those different things that I am now. And where this really comes back is understanding from a business principle, the single best way to create kind of instant rapport with your prospects is by bringing out your real personality, your true self. Yet, so many of us, whether it's online or in real life, we're holding ourselves back. And really, I want to dive into this deeply and why this is and how to change it with Maxwell Maltz, with Psycho Cybernetics, continuing on this theme, this trend, like I talked about in the last episode, with mindset. And why does mindset matter? Why do we deal with this interior world, personality, and all these things? Simply put, income improvement follows self-improvement. Period, end of story. If you want to have a more successful business, if you want to achieve your goals, if you want to make more money, if you want to be more successful, you've got to do the internal work. Income improvement follows self-improvement. Success is an inside job, right? So here's the thing. When Maxwell Maltz, this is such a great book on mindset. It's really impacted me, and I've told these stories before, Psycho Cybernetics, and he talks about when you have kind of excessive negative feedback or self-criticism, you know, you really inhibit yourself. You really become, it's not even the term self-conscious, you become others conscious. I love what he talks about there. He says, you know, you're too worried about what everyone else is thinking. You're being overly careful and you're being too worried about other consciousness, meaning when you're presenting, when you're speaking, when you're putting together content, when you're recording a podcast, you're making a video, you're writing an email, you're too worried about what will other people think of me to just let your true self out, let your real personality out. That was what held me back all through grade school and high school. Was I was terrified. I was so afraid of if I'm put my real self out there and get rejected, how will I ever live, right? Like I will not, I will die from the shame. And again, everyone has their own backstory. For me, you know, growing up, a lot of emotional trauma and abuse and things like that as a kid really was very shame-filled and very fearful about I don't want others to see me as vulnerable or weak or anything like that. And so what I did was I would never step out because I didn't want to risk being exposed and being vulnerable. And so even looking at, and I'm not saying that's the issue with Tommy on our basketball team. He could just be a massive introvert, right? But either way, on that basketball court between the lines, I need him to be a killer. For our team to win, I need him to play at his best to unleash this talent he has. Because I watch him and he inhibits himself. He holds himself back. And when I somehow am able to turn that switch, he's draining jumpers. He's grabbing rebounds. He's dribbling the ball. He's making plays. I'm like, that we need to figure out how to disinhibit him. And the same is true for you with sales, with putting out content, with having conversations with prospects or customers. Are you inhibiting yourself? Are you too others conscious? Because that's the big thing in today's marketplace and online world with business is the strongest, best way to create rapport, to be memorable, is to be yourself, is to really just be your authentic, true self. The stronger you can be as far as letting your real personality come out with conversations that you have, content you create, you know, clients that you talk to, customers, prospects, the stronger you can be, the more memorable you are. And not stronger meaning like gregarious or yelling, but just being more your authentic self. Instead of worrying about, you know, I want to say this or I want to, you know, use this analogy or, you know, do this goofy joke or share this funny photo. Like, oh, wait, I won't look professional. Oh, wait, you know, people might judge me. Oh, wait, that's where you're losing it. Because the biggest sin in marketing is to be boring, right? And the number one asset you have in the marketplace online is you, right? It's your own personality. It's your own unique style of communication. It's your own unique story. And if you're not sharing that, if you're inhibiting yourself, then you're holding back. If you're just trying to blend in, no one's going to remember you. And we know this. Everything is commoditized. Every service out there, there's commodity. People can shop based on what they're looking for. Your big advantage, people are going to look to, you know, bond with you, to connect with you. You've got to get that out through your personality so that you can attract people who say, I really like your style. I like your sense of humor. I like your stories. I like the way that you talk. I want to work with you. Yes, there's a million other coaches, LinkedIn trainers, SEO consultants, whatever it is you do, but I like you personally. That's the key and the reason it matters. Now, going back to mindset and understanding how this plays out, reading a couple of passages from Psycho Cybernetics, he's talking about here the value of indifference. And they're talking about it in an academic setting. This is so fascinating because whether you drop this into a classroom, a corporate environment, it's all the same. The value of indifference. And this is what Maltz is talking about. He says, And he's quoting William James, who's another great mindset guy from, you know, a long way back, a little historical note here. But who are the scholars who get rattled in the recitation room, asked William James? Who are those scholars that get, you know, frazzled and rattled in the recitation room in front of the class? And he says, those who think of the possibilities of failure and feel the great importance of the act. Who are those who recite well? Who are those who do good in front of the class? Often it's those who are most indifferent. Their ideas just reel themselves out of their memories of their own accord. And what he's talking about is, if you can come in and be indifferent about the outcome, you're going to be more successful. I'm talking about a sales conversation. I'm talking about, you know, presenting yourself to a client. I'm talking about creating content, especially when it bottles up you, you know, if it's a podcast, a video, whatever. If you can be indifferent and not others conscious, I should say, you'll do a better job. It'll be more authentic. It'll be more the real you. This is what's so fascinating. And Mull says, he says, self-consciousness is really others consciousness. And he says, it's a cause and effect, right? Because if you're so worried about what everyone else is thinking, you're kind of throttling yourself. You're holding yourself back. And it's not to say you should ignore that and just be totally tone deaf when you get in front of a room of people or you're presenting, but he's really talking about having that power of indifference, of I, you know what, whether I sink or swim, whether I, you know, fly or fail, I'm going to go out and I'm going to do what I think I need to do. I'm going to do it my way, and let's just see what happens. And the other big thing for this too is, where's your sense of validation coming from? That for me has been a big piece of it, especially with my backstory, is saying, okay, no one in this room is allowed to validate or invalidate me based off my performance today. No one on this webinar is allowed to invalidate me. Someone that writes an angry response to a sales email I do, I'm not giving them permission and power to invalidate me as a human being, right? I am indifferent to whether or not they love or hate this, because again, I'm not going to be so others conscious that I hold myself back. And this is what he talks about. Malt says from the book, what others think creates inhibition. When you become too consciously concerned about what others think, you become too careful to consciously try and please these other people. When you become too sensitive to the real, and this is good too, the real or the fancied disapproval, imagining this, of other people, then you have this excessive negative feedback. You inhibit yourself and you have poor performance. When you're consciously, you know, and constantly monitoring your every act or word or mannerism, again, you become inhibited or self-conscious. You become too careful to make a good impression. And in doing so, you choke off, you restrain, you inhibit your creative self. That's so important. And you end up making a bad impression, a poor impression. So he says this, and I love this line. The way to make a good impression on other people is simple. Never consciously try to make a good impression on them. Never act or fail to act purely for consciously contrived effect. Never wonder consciously what the other person is thinking of you or how he or she is judging you. And I see this in my own experience when if I don't really know someone's story or background, and say it's an inbound sales lead, and they filled out a type form and I call the phone and I haven't done a bunch of research or deep digging. I just look at some of the things they've shared. I call them. I just treat them like I would treat any prospect. I don't like try to put on airs. I don't get nervous. I don't overthink it. I just, hey, yeah, what are you looking for? Okay, this is, you know, we can help you or not help you. The only times I've really struggled is if I research the person too much and get intimidated and go, wow, well, they seem like a really big deal. Look at all these things they've done. Oh, I don't know. Am I not worthy to talk to them? And one of the key things I've learned over time, and there was a great line from a book that a guy wrote, Keith Ferrazzi wrote a book called Never Eat Alone. It was all about networking and how he kind of built his personal brand through networking and connecting with, you know, people that really helped him advance in his career. And one of his big tips about dealing with famous people or important people or celebrities was very simply, he said, folks are folks. Like, people are people. Just treat them like you would treat your next door neighbor. Treat them like a regular person. Don't come in and be a fanboy or a fangirl. don't come in from a, you know, posture of I'm not worthy, like Wayne's World. We're not worthy when they see Aerosmith or was Alice Cooper. Like, just treat them like a regular person. And I have found that advice to be so helpful. Just folks are folks. Like, even when I'm talking to a big name, New York Times bestselling guru, whatever, celebrity, it's just like, treat them like a regular person. And what's really interesting is the people at that level, they really respect and appreciate and enjoy that you're just treating them like your regular Joe or regular Jane. And I think the reason is most people in their orbit are intimidated, are fanboy or fangirl, are like afraid, right? And they're just, you know, at the end of the day, they're regular people. Like, they had some sort of humble beginnings. They had some sort of journey. Yes, now they're, you know, the CEO of a multi-billion dollar company, whatever. But at the end of the day, they're still a person, right? So that's the other thing, is being indifferent is the secret to making a good impression. That really is. And not throttling yourself, not toning yourself down, not changing how you operate in order to try to please the other person or the audience. I really think that's true, because people, especially today, are craving authenticity, transparency, knowing what they're getting so they can trust you, yes or no. Instead of everyone posing online and pretending and, you know, bait and switch, or, well, you're not really what I thought you're like in real life. I see this a lot when I, you know, go around and have spoken at events with other kind of big name people. I'm not big name, but being in an event with a big name person, where I get to go into the green room or the behind the scenes stuff at some of these bigger conventions where I've been, you know, able to speak or present. And it's interesting, because some of them are very true and authentic to what you see online. You're like, oh yeah, you are just, you know, exactly how you present online. And other people are totally opposite. They're just, I'm just like, you, I could not believe what a phony you are. Like, you present this way. Or some of the people, it's interesting too, like, they've never shared in their online persona and their online content that they're a massive introvert. So when I meet them one-on-one, I'm thinking they're some huge extrovert, right? Because I meet them behind the scenes, all their videos are hyped up and jacked up and, you know, very extroverted behaviors. And I know they're doing that because they have to communicate and get people excited. But I meet them behind the scenes and then they're like, they run away. Like, they're the introvert, they're in the corner. And I'm like, did I do something wrong? And then someone else say, oh no, they're actually, in real life, they're actually a huge introvert. And I'm like, man, that's like such dissonance, like brand confusion for me, because on your videos, you're so friendly and approachable and engaging and jacked up. And then when I meet you in real life, you, like, I can tell like you're an introvert because you seem like you don't like me, or you don't want to respond to me, or, you know, you'd walk away. And so it's taken a lot of learning for me to go, it would be very valuable for those individuals to own their introvertedness online and be like, hey, just so you know, I am a huge introvert, but that doesn't mean I can't be out there communicating, engaging, and being able to share with people who are, you know, followers or fans or audience members. Hey, if you do come up to an event, don't get turned off or don't get upset. I am an introvert, you know, so if I'm, you know, exhausted for the day, you know, and you come up to me at the end of a speech, I may not be super friendly. Like, that would help, right? Because again, we're always looking for that transparency, authenticity, the personal brand, the real life person matches the online persona. But to bring this all in, you know, to really understand how to implement this for you, you know, how to build instant rapport with people, how to make a good first impression is really just to be indifferent. Don't consciously try to make a good impression. Just be yourself. For me, you know, it's very interesting because I love my wife, but she'll sometimes cringe at me with the way I talk to people, or I don't wear like a collared shirt. I just wear a t-shirt and a baseball hat on a call, a prospecting call. And it's like, yeah, that's just how I am. And that may cost me some sales, that may not, but it attracts a ton of people that enjoy that, connect with it, whatever it might be, right? And we always are going to do that to ourselves, or, you know, look at the outside looking in and go, oh, be too conscious about how we're doing it. Not that, again, not that you want to be unprofessional, not that you want to be inappropriate, anything like that, but just be your authentic self. Be indifferent to the outcome of the action, the event, the conversation, and just be real. And I think people, What you'll do with that is you'll have a strong personal brand, an authentic personal brand, and what you'll do as you meet people, either online or in real life, you will attract people that connect with you at that know, like, and trust level, that cave person level, that say, I like you, you're an introvert like me, or I like you, you're an extrovert like me, we're bonding over all this stuff, or you're sharing your journey and your passion for sailing, me too, I'm bonding with you over that. Or you'll repel people that would be a terrible fit, right? You'll repel those people that are like, wait a minute, I thought you were an extrovert. In real life, working with you, you're an introvert. This is awkward. We're not connecting, whatever, right? I'm not sure how to approach you. Like, you'll repel people who aren't a good fit by being your authentic self. And that's the good news, is having that abundance mindset is there's plenty of prospects. There's plenty of paying gigs. There's plenty of people who are going to want to hire you and work with you. Don't get so scared and get into that scarcity mindset of, I can't lose a deal. I have to change who I am to close this, or I have to play games, or it's just not worth it. It ends up, you know, especially now running an agency kind of as one of my full-time things and bringing in so many different clients. My business coach says this all the time, that client selection is the name of the game. Like, one bad client, one bad fit can really drain you personally. It can drain your team. It can drain your time. It can really drain morale. It can drain resources. It can just be a nightmare. And so, you know, it really helps your client selection to be indifferent upfront, to be authentic, to be transparent, to be yourself, because that will quickly help you either attract and bond with the right person or repel them and say, you know what, you're probably not a fit for us. This is our style. This is our approach. We don't do things that way. That's okay, right? Like, we're not gonna change our whole system to fit how you like to do it. You know, I'm sure there's another agency out there that can do it the way you want. And believe me, I know this. It's scary. It's scary to turn away people and to turn down business. But it's also very empowering. You know, it's empowering to say, I'm not desperate. You know, my friend Paul Klein, the just amazing guy on pricing and consulting, paulklein.net, giving you a shout out, Paul, talks about the stench of desperation. And I've heard other people, like commission breath, you know, like, we're so desperate to close the deal, we'll basically just, you know, fold over and prostrate ourselves and whatever you need, I'll adjust to whatever you want. You never want to do that. You never want to do that for a simple reason of, you're giving all the control over to the customer, the client, the prospect. And you can't run a business efficiently if you don't have and honor kind of your own systems, your own setup, your own scenarios, you know, like you normally do, right? So that's a key thing, is be indifferent. Don't inhibit yourself. Don't be others conscious, right? Just be yourself. It's amazing how that builds rapport and makes a good first impression, because regardless, the person's like, I get it. I get who you are, what you're about. I appreciate that you're being real with me. That's cool, right? And what I found too is, because my normal behavior is pretty informal and pretty chatty and humorous and joking around a lot, I don't get on a call with a prospect and start with, you know, formal, rigid, professional kind of corporate talk. I just start joking around and mention stuff I've learned about them online, about hobbies or their sports teams. They let their guard down. We start having fun, or it gets awkward and they're like, you know, whatever. And then it's like, okay, well, we're not a good fit. Like, we're not going to click personally. So either way, take action with this. It is so important, whether you're, you know, that seventh grader trying to get out your inner, you know, LeBron James in basketball, or whether you're in the corporate setting wanting to close more deals. This is such a good lesson. So thank you so much for listening to this episode. Appreciate you. Get after it. And we'll see you soon on another episode of Nemo Radio.